Hello, everyone. This is your host, Cobra Number One, and you are listening to The Barbershop here on CobrasInAction.org and the Black Talk Radio Network. Exposing racism, white supremacy for exactly what it is so that you and your loved ones can counter this nasty, stinking, wretched, disgusting system. The purpose of this podcast is to eliminate all confusion in regards to racism and what it is, so that those who are classified as black are no longer confused. We broadcast weekly. We try to get the show on Wednesdays from 5 to 6 p.m., but sometimes we get it out on Thursday from 5 to 6 p.m. But it will be right here on CobrasInAction.org and the Black Talk Radio Network, so just keep checking. Inform any black person you think that may be remotely interested in countering racism or what we're doing. Spread the word. We find this show to be necessary because before a problem can be solved, it has to be identified and understood. And too many black people do not understand racism. Visit us at CobrasInAction.org, a website dedicated to countering racism and replacing it with justice. Because too many black people remain confused about racism, we created this site. Not only do we articulate precisely what racism is, but we also give specifics on how to counter it. Click on the menu tab and listen to archives of The Barbershop. Read articles on racism and strategies and tactics on how to counter racism. And listen to the radio network, Cobra Radio, the most dangerous radio network in the world. Once you're on the site, please like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter, YouTube, and SoundCloud. We're always publishing content to all of our social media sites, articles, videos, and music, so please follow. We have two new podcasts, Flex Talk, a podcast dedicated to improving the physical, mental, and spiritual health of black people, and Yurugu, an analysis of white people. We do Flex Talk on Wednesdays from 11 to 1 p.m., and Yurugu is not on a set schedule yet, but just go to CobrasInAction.org and click the menu tab, and then click on podcasts to listen to any of the shows. We're also on iTunes. Just search for Cobra Podcasts and subscribe. Today, I want to go over the meaning of the term white, because this is essential to victims of racism understanding if white people are ever going to effectively be countered. I made a statement last week on The Barbershop that all white people are racist. Today I'm going to explain just exactly how they are all racist through the examination of the term white. You are listening to The Barbershop. Be right back. To the people who classify themselves as white, stop mistreating black people. We're waking up to your refined racism games, and we're on to you. So the next time one of your race soldier cracker cops shoot down a black person like a dog in the street, know we're watching. The next time you white people want to send donations and inspirational cards to honorary racists like George Zimmerman, know we're watching. We're on to you. Game over.
In the system of white supremacy, anything that non-white people do nowadays in 2016 that is non-constructive and has a constructive effect on the behavior and the, you might say, the welfare, the well-being of non-white people, the white supremacists are not in favor of it. Otherwise, how are you going to have white supremacy if you're going to have black people oriented, thinking about having a vision of, working toward, doing things that are of constructive value. And this includes the third area of activity. You don't want any black entertainment to be constructive. You want it to be non-constructive. You want black people to be doing things that don't build up anything. Just everything falling down, everything deteriorated. I mean, you want black people to glorify killing each other, all right? You know, in your entertainment. I mean, you know, if you're going to have an assembly of black people somewhere to get, where they agree to all get together and whatnot, you got to have some gunfire there. You got to have some bodies dropping. You got to have people fleeing for their lives and whatnot after they come together. All right, that's what they came together for. Everybody understands when you get a bunch of black people together, it's going to be something evil that's going to happen. Otherwise, if it's not evil happening, what are we together for? That's got to be a part of black culture. I mean, hey, terrible things are going to happen. I mean, whether it's a soccer game, I mean, you know, and somewhere along the line, people are going to start punching each other out, kicking each other, shooting maybe, or something like that. Or whether it's any event, a big barbecue or something, on the black side of town, and the white supremacists sit back and say, okay, you know how they're going to act. See, get all geared up to have with the riot gear and whatnot, because, you know, they are very destructive people, and they come together with the idea of being destructive.
Mm-hmm.
This is what they know. This is their habit. This is their culture. See, so we want to do away with that in the compensatory counter-racist era, to where we should be dedicated to going with the rest of what we call the infinity. No more of that nonsense. And don't come together with that in mind, and don't even, you know, anything that looks like it's going in that direction, just don't participate in it. Don't.
Victims Guaranteed Qualification, VGQ.
There was a lot of backlash from people about that. Would you change it, what you said, or you still feel the same way? What's your thought on Black Lives Matter?
What is it? What do you mean?
The idea is that there's this movement called Black Lives Matter, thinking that the rest of America didn't seem to understand that Black Lives Matter.
It just sounds weird. I don't know that you put a name on. It's not a name. It's not whatever, whatever. It's somebody got shot by police for a reason. I am a young black rich. If that don't let you know that America understand Black Matter these days, I don't know what it is. Don't come at me with that dumb, man. My life matter, especially to my.
Do you separate yourself from it?
I don't feel connected to a damn thing. That ain't got nothing to do with me. If you do, you crazy. You connected to this flag, right? As I'm connected, I'm a gangbanger, man. I'm connected.
He ended our interview angrily. Lil Wayne is in the business of making music, not apology.
Stop doing anything that has show-off value. Stop trying to attract attention to yourself by showing off. Because once you get everybody's attention, what are you going to do with the attention that you got? That's a logical question. Remember, I keep saying all problems can be solved through the process of questions and answers.
Yes.
So you should ask yourself, why are you trying to get people's attention? And what are you going to do with the attention that you got once you get it? In other words, if I'm standing on a street corner and I say, hey, everybody look at my hairstyle. I want everybody, I mean, you know, get out of their cars. I mean, you know, park them somewhere and come back and take a look. I mean, this is me. I just got a new hairstyle. I want everybody to see my hairstyle. I mean, all this stuff that you all are doing, you're wasting your time. Come and look at me. Come and do something constructive in your life. Do something that makes sense for once in your Negro lives. Come and look at me. Neely Fuller, I'm standing on this corner, and I just got a new hairstyle that nobody in the world has ever had. So you need to learn from this. You need to straighten out your lives by looking at me and my hairstyle. Now, so the people come, and they assemble by the thousands, and they look at me and my new hairstyle, or my new tattoo, or my new angle that I use when I sag my pants. I am getting people's attention.
Yes.
So the question now is, now that I have everybody's attention, what is supposed to be what? The constructive result.
Okay.
I should be able to answer that question. What?
Should, yeah.
How has this contributed to making a betterment of solving their problems for the rest of their lives?
Okay.
If an officer stops you, always be polite and never ever run away. Promise mama you'll keep your hands inside. Is it a gun? Is it a knife? Is it a wallet? This is your life. It ain't no secret. It ain't no secret. No secret, my friend. You can get killed just for living in your American skin.
This is the problem with black people. I don't think any kind of singing, dancing, jumping up and down, waiting for some mythical, magical appearance from something out of the sky, I don't think any of that is going to stop you from getting smacked in the mouth. You get smacked, you get punched, you get kicked in the mouth, you smack, punch, and kick back, period.
Welcome back to the show. I'm your host, Cobra Number One, and you are listening to The Barbershop here on CobrasInAction.org and the Black Talk Radio Network. Before I get started, I just want to say that racism, white supremacy, is real. It's not just some little cute phrase that I'm saying for shits and giggles. If you are not convinced of their superior position, just look up the 13th Amendment. See how slavery was never abolished and how it has morphed into what they call mass incarceration. But when you scratch beneath the surface, it becomes quite clear that it's just flat out slavery. Remember, most black men are in prison for nonviolent crimes and are put there by a criminal justice system controlled by white people, the ones that make all the rules and laws, to continue exploiting niggers for labor. Only a people in a superior position can enslave another people, folks. Deal with it. I am working on a book, Racism is White Supremacy. Well, the book is actually finished. The cover is being worked on. And I'm also working on the album, which will accompany the book. Because of the great influence music has on shaping ideas and values, I have always made it a goal of mine to not just write a book on racism, but to also translate the ideas of the book into music so that these ideas can be felt. This book is an introduction to racism, what it is, and ideas on how to counter it. There are several books that need to be read by all black people for a complete understanding of racism. For an introduction to racism, I suggest my book, Racism is White Supremacy, which will be out in the marketplace very soon. Nellie Fuller's book, The United Independent Compensatory Code System Concept, a textbook workbook for thought, speech, and or action for victims of racism, white supremacy. This is a must for all black people. And for theory on why white people behave the way they do, I suggest both Dr. Francis Chris Welsing's The ISIS Papers and Dr. Marimba Anai's Urugu. With the election of Donald Trump, it has become painfully clear to me just how lost we are as a people when it comes to racism and understanding that white people collectively intend harm to all non-white people, especially black people. So I'm going to use the barbershop to go over concepts in my book because this stuff can't be repeated enough. We have to get a much clearer understanding of racism because if we do not, we will not survive as a people. First, it is important to understand that the term white is a racial classification. Last week, I discussed the origins of the concept of race and that race as a concept is used to arrange groups of people in hierarchical systems based on physical attributes, for example, skin color. The term white is synonymous with white race. So when people classify themselves as white, they are saying they are a member of the white race. Europeans' usage of the term white race coincides with the Atlantic slave trade. The terms racism and race became part of the dominant ideology of society in the context of the African slave trade at the dawn of capitalism in the 1500s and 1600s, according to the International Socialist Review. So when a white person refers to themselves as white, they are classifying themselves racially. Now, why would there be a need for someone to classify themselves racially? They do so to accept and acknowledge their dominant position at the top of the racial classification system. Who are they dominant over, you ask? All non-white people. This is why I say all white people are racist. For after all, what is a white person? I mean, a white person doesn't really have white skin. Although we call it white, it isn't really white. White people are not referring to their skin color when they classify themselves as white. They are referring to their racial classification, and by doing such, they are practicing racism. And how do you describe a person that practices racism? As a racist. Now, on the opposite end of the spectrum, you have black people or the black race. It is important to note that unlike white people, black people do not do any of the classifying, but are classified. So an individual person can refer to themselves as Native American, Hawaiian, Asian, 50% Negro, 25% European, 25% East Indian. It means nothing. Because to the people that dominate, you are a member of the black race. Raven Simone, Tiger Woods, you're black. Regardless of what you say, you are a member to the people where it matters the most, to the people that have so much influence on your life and how it's going to be. You are a member of the black race, period. You can call yourself anything you want. And me personally, I respect people's wishes. So if a black person wants me to call them Native American, I call them Native American. If a black person wants me to call them a boogaloo, that's what I will call them. But let's keep it 100. You, to the people that matter, you are a member of the black race. It is important to understand that you as a black person are classified as black because white people classify themselves as white. The idea of a black race is the product of the desire by white people or the white race to develop a hierarchical system by which they can justify mistreating non-white people. Niggas. This is why I say on the barbershop, not to put too much in the black culture. It's a very trashy culture. It's a very shitty culture. Why? Because everything we do is in response to our mistreatment. Culture is what you do, folks. It's everything we do. And everything we do is a response to our oppression. Black culture is a very trashy and shitty culture because its origins come from the trashy and shitty needs of a trashy and shitty people, white people. I'll stop there. You are listening to The Barbershop here on CobrasInAction.org and the Black Talk Radio Network.
Well, I've heard people say, in fact, a person told me some years ago, said, Fuller, you're flying blind. You're wasting your time. The race issue cannot, the race problem cannot be solved. It can only be discussed. And so I thought about that because I take into consideration everybody's statements, and I should. And I said to myself, if the race problem can't be solved, there's no point in discussing it. I mean, just resign ourselves. But then I wouldn't have written a book on counter-racism if I didn't think this race problem could be solved and could be solved swiftly. It's just a matter of pushing the correct buttons, and I try to tell what buttons to push in the book that I have written, and I try to do it on air simply by the process of what? Questions and answers, because all problems that's made by people can be solved by people through the process of what? Questions and answers, because every question has a correct answer. No such thing as a question without an answer. And there's no such thing as a problem that can't be solved that's made by people. If people made the problem, people can solve the problem. But what it is, black people have a culture that's not designed to solve problems. We have a culture that's designed to actually glorify the problems that we have and to make new problems. Truth be told, we don't have a counter-racist culture. And I have tried to write in my book, because what is a culture? Culture is nothing but what you do. And we are not doing the things that will solve a problem called racism. We're simply not doing it. Why? Because that's not our priority. We have what we call a black culture priority, and it's mostly to glorify what we have already done and what we are doing now. And it's not worth 2 cents. Why? Because it's not working against the system of white supremacy. That's why.
Yeah.
It doesn't work.
True that.
We need a more sophisticated culture, a counter-racist culture. I try to outline that in the book.
Victims Guarantee Qualification, VGQ.
And another thing, when you say integration, it comes under intermarriage too, right? All
right.
Been together.
Right, sure.
And I'm sure no intelligent white person watching this show, or no intelligent white man in his or her right white mind, want black boys and black girls marrying their white sons and daughters, and in return introducing their grandchildren as half brown, kinky haired black people.
I wouldn't object to that.
Well, you wouldn't, but a lot of them would.
Well, I'm sure a lot of people would. No, it's just the
point. What I'm trying to say is this. You don't have it. You say you don't. You don't have it. You really ain't gonna have it. You're on the show, and you got to say that. But
that's not true.
Why would you want to do that?
Because I don't think I'm any different from you. You see.
Yeah, we much different.
That's, I mean, I think society's made us different.
You know, we're different. We're all together.
But society's made us different.
No, not society. God made us different.
No, we're just human beings. He made all of us.
We all listen. Blue birds fly with blue birds. Red birds wanna be with red birds. Listen. Tell me when I'm wrong. Pigeons wanna be with pigeons.
But
tell
we
me
have
when
intelligence.
I'm wrong. Well,
we should have.
They don't have intelligence, but yet they stay together. We should have more intelligence than them, right? Buzzards are with buzzards. Yeah. Buzzards are with buzzards. Bluebirds are with bluebirds. They all are birds, but they've got different cultures. The eagles like to hang out in the mountains. The buzzards like to fly around the desert.
Well,
the bluebird like to fly around the trees and the grass.
There'd be certain problems a buzzard mating with a sparrow, wouldn't there?
What?
There'd be certain...
Right.
Right.
We have problems, too.
No,
I don't see...
I don't see no black and white couples in England or America walking around proud holding their children.
That's because society...
And going out.
That's society's fault. We've got to educate people around it.
Well, life is too short for me to be raised catching hell for something like that. I'd rather go and be my own. I have a beautiful daughter, beautiful wife. They look like me. We're all happy, and I don't have no trouble. And I ain't that much in love with no woman to go through all that hell. Ain't no one woman that good. You understand?
I understand, yeah. I understand. I think it's sad that
it ain't sad because I want my child to look like me. Every intelligent person wants his child to look like him. I'm sad because I want to blot out my race and lose my beautiful identity. Chinese love Chinese. They love the little slanted out pretty brown skinned babies. Pakistanis love their culture. Jewish people love their culture. A lot of Catholics don't want to marry a number of Catholics. They want the religion to stay the same. Who want to spot up yourself and kill your race? You're a hater of your people if you don't want to stay who you are. You shame what God made you. God didn't make no mistake when he made us all like we were.
I think that's a philosophy of despair.
Despair.
I really do.
It ain't no despair. Yeah, number one, can't no woman. Let me tell you something. Yeah, I'll tell you. Listen, no woman on this whole earth, not even a black woman in Muslim countries, can please me and cook for me and socialize and talk to me like my American black woman. No woman, at last, is a white woman. Can really identify with me and my feelings and the way I act and the way I talk. And you can't take no Chinese man and give him no Puerto Rican woman and holler about we in love and you emotionally in love and physically, but really they're not happy because she's going to hear some Puerto Rican music, he's going to hear some Chinese music. And they're going to be clashing all the time. It's just nature. You can do what you want, but it's nature to want to be with your own. I want to be with mine. I love my people. That's all. I hate.
Well, in the system of white supremacy, anything that non-white people do nowadays in 2016 that is non-constructive and has a constructive effect on the behavior and the, you might say, the welfare, the well-being of non-white people, the white supremacists are not in favor of it. Otherwise, how are you going to have white supremacy if you're going to have black people oriented, thinking about, having a vision of, working toward, doing things that are of constructive value? And this includes the third area of activity. You don't want any black entertainment to be constructive. You want it to be non-constructive. You want black people to be doing things that don't build up anything. Just everything falling down, everything deteriorated. I mean, you want black people to glorify killing each other, all right, you know, in your entertainment. I mean, you know, if you're going to have an assembly of black people somewhere to get, where they agree to all get together and whatnot, you got to have some gunfire there. You got to have some bodies dropping. You got to have people fleeing for their lives and whatnot after they come together. All right, that's what they came together for. Everybody understands when you get a bunch of black people together, it's going to be something evil that's going to happen. Otherwise, if it's not evil happening, what are we together for? That's got to be a part of black culture. I mean, hey, terrible things are going to happen. I mean, whether it's a soccer game, I mean, you know, and somewhere along the line, people are going to start punching each other out, kicking each other, shooting maybe, or something like that. Or whether it's any event, a big barbecue or something, on the black side of town. And the white supremacists sit back and say, okay, you know how they're going to act. See, get all geared up to have with the riot gear and whatnot. Because, you know, they are very destructive people. And they come together with the idea of being destructive.
Mm-hmm.
This is what they know. This is their habit. This is their culture. See, so we want to do away with that in the compensatory counter-racist era. Where we should be dedicated to going with the rest of what we call the infinity. No more of that nonsense. And don't come together with that in mind, and don't even, you know, anything that looks like it's going in that direction, just don't participate in it. Don't go.
Right.
See, let's get down to the doing part. Just say, no. If I don't have a guarantee, this is going to be constructive.
Welcome back to the show. We're talking about the term white. And before I get out of here, I'm going to touch on good white people. But first, I just want to give a few thoughts on some of the things going on in the news. So yesterday we found out that Beyonce is having twins. She made a big deal about it on Instagram, and like 100 million black people immediately responded to this news. And my thing is, why is this important? This is an entertainer. She's having a child. Well, she's having twins. But in the whole grand scheme of things, how does this counter your problem? How does this contribute to the fighting of racism, white supremacy? I mean, the way people were responding, especially women, you would have thought that the system of racism, white supremacy was destroyed. You would have thought that all of the world's problems had been eliminated. Everyone was rejoicing. Oh my God, B's pregnant. Oh my God, B's pregnant. Oh wow. This really made my day. You still living in a system of racism, white supremacy. If a white person incorrectly identifies you doing something criminal, if you are incorrectly incriminated, do you know what that means for you as a black person? Do you know what that means for your black son, your miserable nigga son in the system of racism, white supremacy, when he's fingered for doing something incorrectly and he has to go through the justice system? What can you do about that? You have no power. This is part of what racism, white supremacy is, folks. And I see a whole lot of people wasting time concerning themselves with news like this. Beyonce, B's pregnant. I don't give a shit if B's pregnant. I don't dislike Beyonce. I mean, there's nothing wrong with Beyonce. I don't even know her. What I dislike is our priorities. We're all on Instagram playing around. Everyone's compensating, showing themselves with dollar bills that they got from their parents, that they took from their parents' wallets. They took it, and then they have to hurry up to take the picture so then they can put it right back so that their parents don't know that their $20 bills or that their $100 bills have gone missing. Because you want to compensate and pretend that you are something and that you have things and that you have it a certain way, a way in which you really don't have it. You don't have it like that. Most black people are not paid well. You are not balling. You're not doing it big. You're not big time. You're not of any importance. You get your money from white people. White people tell you where you're going to work, what time you're going to show up, how you're going to work, when you're going to get paid. White people do this. Black people are not big time. All right. So Beyonce, all on Instagram. And another thing, why are you posting your life on Instagram? I mean, really, what as a black person do you have to post on Instagram aside a bunch of lies and a bunch of misery? Because black people are miserable. I'm miserable. You're miserable. All of the prices are high. Everything is expensive. You have bills, 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 bills. And most of you can't pay your bills. Do you think that's by accident? Do you think it's by accident that black people are paid the lowest? Most black people are barely making it. And then we want to prop up. We want to put on a pedestal those black people that white people have decided to showcase. You have a black person that makes $500 million a year. Or better yet, a black person that's worth $500 million. This is enough money to account for, I mean, hundreds of $60,000 salaries. And all this money, all these resources goes to one black person. And black people are so blinded, and black people are so interested in cozying up to white people and being accepted by crackers, we don't even realize just how foul that is. Jay-Z and Beyonce are collectively worth $500 million. But yet most black people can barely keep the damn lights on. And niggas think this is an accomplishment. They say, oh yeah, man, Jay-Z a boss, man. He doing it, man. He balling, man. Yeah. Man, that nigga, man, he got power. Jay-Z, Beyonce, Kanye, Young Thug, Baby of Cash Money. I don't give a shit how many suitcases of money Baby from I don't give a shit how many suitcases full of money Baby from Cash Money has. Who's giving you that money? Who prints the money? Who determines all of the rules and regulations that govern the money and how it's distributed? You are living in a system of racism, white supremacy. You can buy all the houses you want. You can buy all the cars you want. Whose cars are you buying? These are white people's cars. And don't give me no shit about, oh, well, why are you thinking in terms of black and white? I didn't create the system. I just told you where white comes from. White people created this dichotomy. I didn't create this. Europeans are the ones that's always categorizing based on value, splitting everything up, objectifying everything. This is how you get racism, fool. They're always categorizing, splitting things up, not looking at things as a whole, but splitting things up into objectionable parts to be dissected and to be assigned values. Like human beings have been split up into what we call race. For those of you knuckleheads that weren't listening like 20 minutes ago, you are living in a hierarchical system constructed by crackers. That system is called race. There's a white race. There's an Asian race. I think Asian is a race. There's a Pacific Islander kind of a race. I think they call them like traditional peoples, something like that. But this race is referring to the peoples on the islands. People like the Rock. I like the Rock, by the way. You have a Native American race. There are no races, folks, but white people did all this classifying because they split things up and they like to assign values. And conveniently, the category in which they're in always receives the higher value. So it's Black History Month. You know, enough about Beyonce and Jay-Z and all the little black entertainers. It's Black History Month, and we have Negroes going to visit Donald Trump to talk about Black history. Oh, isn't that nice? I wonder what they're saying. Oh, well, you know, your people have contributed so much. I mean, there's the new movie, Hidden Figures, and, you know, black women, they were so smart. They were so articulate. They knew how to count from 1 to 10, and they knew how to do operations. Oh, wow. I didn't know black people were so capable. I didn't know black people were capable of doing math. Thought it was too complicated, too difficult for their small little pea brains. Happy Black History Month. Sincerely, your president, football head, Donald Trump. Now, these Negroes are sitting in the White House. They're eating white people food. They're eating celery and dip and all types of cheeses and crackers. Crackers love crackers. And they have all types of dip. And they're all, and you know, unfortunately, black people are not really comfortable around white people. So when we get around white people, as what they're doing right now, or whenever they met with Donald Trump, when they were around him, they were speaking the best English on their best behavior for this cracker, for this Donald Trump, this football head, this fool. They were on their best behavior for this man, talking proper English. And yes, yes, Mr. Trump, yes, yes. Oh, you're brilliant, yes. Talking about black history. This is a joke. What were they doing? Did Donald Trump get, did Donald Trump pull out like a card, like a deck of cards of all the prominent black people that have served white people and spoke to these black visitors of his as an expert himself on black history? Oh, see, this was Frederick Douglass, and he was friends with Abraham Lincoln. Yes, 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 I know this, yes. And this over here is George Washington Carver, the peanut man. He created peanut butter. Yes, your people are very great, yes. Donald Trump in black history, a joke. And these people meeting with him, these people are being used. They are being used. Steve Harvey was used. Kanye West was used. These black pastors are being used. And by the way, these black pastors are using you, fool. You sitting up here taking all your money and you donating to some church that ain't doing shit. Sitting up here dancing, shaking your butt every Sunday morning, singing, hallelujah, hallelujah, and screaming and fainting and lying. Lying. You're living a lie. Talking about some your award will be in heaven. That makes me sick. That's just a bunch of black people being lazy, not wanting to figure out how to solve their problem. Racism. Your problem is racism, white supremacy. Period. And you had these black pastors sitting up there eating chicken, licking their fingers with Donald Trump like they're big, bad, and important. Nigga, you being used. This man has calculated. He has said, you know what? The niggers don't like me. And I don't want them causing any trouble. Now, I know they are not politically, they're not politically smart at all. They are a politically primitive people. They do not understand power. Hell, most of them don't even understand the powers of the presidency. They don't understand the powers of anything revolving around American government. But what they do understand is symbolism. They understand getting together with white people and holding hands and speaking of sweet pleasantries of how we love each other and how we're all connected and how we're all human. And that's all you have to say. They don't require any action, any tangible results from any promises that you give them. Nah, they don't require that. They just want to feel good. They just want to feel the moment because they are an emotional, musical people. Isn't that right, little Ezra? Look at little Ezra. Oh, yeah. Little Ezra. See, he's so musical. You have to understand his mental. He's an emotional Negro, emotional little creature. Yes, this is how they talk about black people. See, you have white people like to listen to Negro spirituals. Oh, Oh, the singing was so great. The melodies were just awe-inspiring. It moves your soul. And what that really is, folks, is that it's white people sitting back in their gated communities, comfortable. Here you are struggling, can't even keep the heat on. They're sitting back. They're listening to you articulate your problem, begging and pleading and singing. And for them, it's just an opportunity to just sit back and hear about the results of their work. Hear about the results of their efforts to make you miserable. And they love it. They love to hear you grovel. They love to hear you singing and begging and dancing. Oh, you're hurting me. Let me articulate in song Mary J. Blige to Hillary Clinton. When an officer stops you, always be polite. What are you doing? Hillary Clinton does not understand. She doesn't care. She does not care. Assume they don't care, because we've been here for 500 years. White people could have ended their system just like that, and they have chosen not to. So why are you continuously begging these people? Oh, well, they're just ignorant. They don't understand. Yes, they understand. It's been 500 years. They understand. It's their system. They understand what you're going through, fool. Stop being such an idiot. Cowardly. It's disgusting. It makes me sick. Always be polite. And never, never, never promise mama you keep your hands inside. Is it a gun? Is it a knife? Is it a wallet? This is your life. Oh, get the fuck out of here. The one thing she said that is true. If you get stopped by a police officer, don't be a dumb nigga. You better comply. You better, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, because your objective is to get home. Don't be stupid. You don't have any weapons. And then if you get caught up with the police, ain't no black person gonna come save you. That's the whole reason why I'm doing this show. That's the whole reason why I'm doing everything I'm doing. Black people have no power. You are in no position of power to challenge power. So don't be a dumb nigga. Don't be stupid and don't get yourself killed. Think, think, think. Like I said, on Instagram, I saw, with the Beyonce announcement, I noticed a lot of people compensating. Black people don't have nothing. We collectively have nothing. We don't own nothing. We don't control nothing. You know, all we're good for is buying white people's trinkets. You look at how much black women spend on hair. Why are you spending billions of dollars on hair? I'll tell you why. It's because you're compensating, because you've been told that the way you look is ugly. Well, black women are not ugly. And dumb black nigga men, by our behavior, we participate in perpetuating these ideas about black women. The way we treat black women is disgusting. Black women, you're not ugly. Black men, $250, $300 for a pair of shoes. Why are you spending so much money on shoes? It's because you've been told you ain't nothing. You ain't nothing in the system, racism, white supremacy. Nobody wants to hire you. You have to compensate with your clothes. You have to make up for all that nothingness that is yourself as a nigga. And I don't use that term in any kind of endearing kind of a way. And don't tell me, oh, well, you know, you shouldn't use that term because it's hurtful. And then, fool, you living in a hurtful, foul, sick system. And we will be honest and we will be accurate. I'm a nigga. You are a nigga. Until that's the whole point. Until we counter racism, this is what it is. So if you get mad at me for saying nigga, that's good. It shows that you have some humanity about yourself, because nobody doesn't want to be labeled inferior. So you use that energy that makes you upset because I'm using that term. You use that energy to turn right around and counter racism. But don't sit here and bitch and moan and complain about my language and using the term nigger. All that is black people not wanting to acknowledge their problem, wanting to run and hide. We don't run and hide in the barbershop. Before I finish up, I want to say that I heard clips of the T.I. interview with Sway, and I am very happy that you have a rapper, especially of the stature of T.I., that is starting to understand that something is wrong and using their platform at risk to himself, may I add, to try and wake people up the best he can. I don't agree with everything he says, but this is not about agreeing with what he says. Excuse me. This is about acknowledging that you have a black person with enough self-respect to stand out on his own and say something about the injustice that black people are experiencing. So big props to T.I. I'm very happy that you have a black person, a rapper that's doing this. And we can only hope that as time goes on, other rappers will follow suit as well and do the same thing. Black people are overly concerned with good white people. I maintain there are no good white people because all white people are racist. Now, some white people may not identify themselves as white. So how are these people to be viewed? If a person with what we call white skin has not declared him or herself as being a white person, then the proper response is to suspect the individual as being a racist and to be careful. I have no trouble acknowledging that there may be people with what we call white skin that may not actually be racist. It's very possible that there are people with what we call white skin that may totally reject whiteness in thought, speech, and action. But because this is of no consequence in ending the system of racism, white supremacy, seeking out good white people should not be of any concern to black people. If you know a person that looks white, but is not a racist, great. That's great. So you know a person that isn't a racist. Now what? The system of racism, white supremacy is as strong as ever, regardless of your good white person, your good white friend. This is a waste of time concerning ourselves with good white people. Focus on adhering to a code that counters white people. Focus on a code that counters racism. Focus on a code that counters mistreatment. All right, that's the end of the show. I hope you all enjoyed it and found it constructive. I'll be back in a couple of weeks. And when I come back, I will discuss the role of good white people and how they can contribute to ending this problem. Please visit cobrasinaction.org and like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter, YouTube, and SoundCloud by scrolling to the bottom of any page on the site and clicking on the social media icons. Remember, catch the show every Wednesday, sometimes Thursday, from 5 to 6 p.m. here on cobrasinaction.org and the Black Talk Radio Network. And archives of the show are available on www.cobrasinaction.org. This is RG Reed signing off. Until next time, peace.
Stop doing anything that has show-off value. Stop trying to attract attention to yourself by showing off. Because once you get everybody's attention, what are you going to do with the attention that you got? That's a logical question. Remember, I keep saying, all problems can be solved through the process of questions and answers.
Yes.
So you should ask yourself, why are you trying to get people's attention? And what are you going to do with the attention that you got once you get it? In other words, if I'm standing on a street corner and I say, hey, everybody look at my hairstyle. I want everybody, get out of their cars. Park them somewhere and come back and take a look. This is me. I just got a new hairstyle. I want everybody to see my hairstyle. All this stuff that you all are doing, you're wasting your time. Come and look at me. Come and do something constructive in your life. Do something that makes sense for once in your Negro lives. Come and look at me, Neely Fuller. I'm standing on this corner, and I just got a new hairstyle that nobody in the world has ever had. So you need to learn from this. You need to straighten out your lives by looking at me and my hairstyle. Now, so the people come, and they assemble by the thousands, and they look at me and my new hairstyle, or my new tattoo, or my new angle that I use when I sag my pants. I am getting people's attention.
Yes.
So the question now is, now that I have everybody's attention, what is supposed to be what? The constructive result.
Okay.
I should be able to answer that question. What?
Should, yeah.
How has this contributed to making a betterment of solving their problems for the rest of their lives?
Okay.
You know, this is coming from, again, we can only speak from our own personal view. You know, I was an employer in Orlando, Florida. I put 300 people to work in the community. Not one black elected official. When that contract was lost, no one said, let's make sure we continue to keep, you know, black people working. Was I expecting them to do it? No. But it just doesn't happen. We fight. We take the easy issues. Let's talk about black-on-black crime. It's much easier for me to stand up there and talk about black-on-black crime rather than talking about police brutality. It's much easier to have a panel of inviting the police into the community to tell us how we need to behave better rather than holding the police accountable on Front Street. Almost
exactly.
A dozen women were raped here in Oklahoma
Obama
City.
Talking about we need to build a better relationship with the police. How can black people build a relationship with the exact same entity that has been designed to oppress them and deny them their rights? The purpose of the police is to intimidate the oppressed against seeking justice. That's why the police are there. You can't build no relationship with the police. That's like asking a woman who's been raped to build a relationship with her rapist, or somebody who's been stolen from to build a relationship with the thief. That is crazy. You never saw nobody ask the European Jews to build a relationship with the Nazis, but they want black people to build a relationship with the police. And we said we're not doing that. We unapologetically African. We're going to stand up for what's right, and no Uncle Tom bootlegging Negro is going to make us take the line of least resistance, because that's gotten us nowhere in 50 years.